I was born and raised in New York City when the New York Times was considered to be the premier, the empire newspaper, not only of this city, but of the entire country. My parents bought the New York Post at night, but it was the New York Times in the morning and the New York Times on the weekend. And what the various writers of the New York Times said and believed that really shaped what I thought about the world. When I grew up, the New York Times was distinguished from all other daily newspapers by its claim that it was the newspaper of record, as boring as the language and the format had been. We could always count on the New York Times to be our town's newspaper. It reported not only international and national news, but it reported the news of the city, what the mayors did and did not do, the corruption that was going on in City Hall, the cultural life of the city, the social life. I even read the obituaries and Alden Whitman when I was a teenager and older, provided some of the best obituaries that any newspaper ever had and any reader who was obsessed with death, as many of us were, could ever hope to read. Although we always complained, often complained, about the New York Times as a boring, as a tendentious, as a completely unentertaining newspaper, it was for us the model of what news was supposed to be. You have already heard in previous programs of Paper Tiger how the New York Times is become a multinational corporation and a conglomerate, how it's become a conservative instead of a mildly liberal newspaper. And I don't want to spend much time repeating what distinguished commentators like Herb Schiller has actually said. What I'd like to talk about today is something that is profoundly different about the New York Times since 1976 from what it was when I and many of the people who are watching tonight believed the New York Times to be up until about 7 years ago. Today, the New York Times is basically not a newspaper, but a magazine. It is not only a magazine, but it is a magazine whose model, instead of being all the news that's fit to print, is really a magazine whose model is the 7 o'clock news or the 11 o'clock news of any of the major television networks. The New York Times today provides precious little in the way of comprehensive news. For example, the first thing we must say about the New York Times before any other kinds of comments is that the New York Times is not the New York Times. It may be the Times, but it certainly is not a New York newspaper. Not only are most of its readers from suburbs and out of New York City, but that is reflected in its format. The thinnest part of the daily New York Times is the metropolitan section. A metropolitan section which is about as much New York as the New York Yankees are world champions this year. The New York metropolitan section, which is supposed to represent the historical connection that the New York Times has to the city of New York, consists of precious little New York news. In fact, one of the major indications that it's a New York newspaper is the fact that it has a column which is called The City. The City is one column in a paper which addresses many, many other constituencies. The city is, to a large extent, no longer really represented in the New York Times from the perspective of news. What then has the New York Times become? The New York Times, as a daily phenomenon, has approximately, this is Tuesday, October 11th, 32 pages of news. The indication that it is a newspaper is in its first A section. The A section, however, has many other things besides news. For one thing, it includes the entire opinion section on its back, which is a two-page editorial section here. It includes a multitude of advertisements, including the whole back page, which is really basically, in this case, devoted to an investment banking house, which is not unusual for the back page of the New York Times. And it includes the usual, as in this page, chosen randomly the usual 7/8 of an average page, which is devoted fundamentally to advertising. New York Times is a real competitor in its news section to Advertising Age. Advertising Age, which actually gives you more news of advertising than the New York Times, but New York Times, which gives you more advertising than Advertising Age. But there is, of course, in the front page of the New York Times, a modicum of news. I've already mentioned the second section, which is the metropolitan section. And then there is basically a floating crap game of section C. The floating crap game of section C begins on Monday with the Sports Monday, which in my judgment is basically Masculine Monday. It is the male memorial section of the New York Times every Monday in section C. Section C, the Sports Monday, in this case, represents perhaps the most serious social and cultural commentary that one is likely to find in the New York Times. Then we come to Tuesday. Tuesday is Science Times, which not only deals with science, but also deals secondarily with education. Now, Science Times is modeled to a large extent on magazines. The science magazine Omni, and more indirectly, Scientific American, and even more indirectly, The Source, with a capital S, which is the magazine of the American Association of Science, which is the called Science itself. Science Times also has a little subsection which is usually devoted to education. It consists normally of one article on education, in this case, articles about teacher pay, and the rest of it is reasonably interesting information about science. And this Tuesday, perhaps, is the great success of the New York Times section C. Wednesday, we get the living section, which in this case talks about the essential kitchen, choosing the basics. Now, the living section is modeled basically after Julia Child, the Ladies Home Journal, Women's Home Companion, and the 50s conception of the woman as a homemaker. The New York Times apparently has forgotten that women 50% to 55% are really out to work, and they think basically they're out to lunch. And in fact, this is the Wednesday section is the tribute of the New York Times basically to ancient history. Then we have section C, Thursday, which is the home section. And in every one of the Thursday home sections, the best part of the home section is not the furniture and the designs for today's kitchen, which most of us either can't afford or wouldn't buy even if we could, because it's basically the conservative old crap. But it is also the time when we learn not about women, as we might have in the old women sections. We learn it now in the home section, and what passes for a women or feminist section is to be found in the home section. Also fashion, also the memorials of such women luminaries as Helen Hayes. It is interesting that feminism is not in section A, which is the news section, but feminism is in section C. And finally, the weekend section, which is where to go to the movies. The movies, obviously, in this case, the theater, the dance, and so on, is normally the second most interesting section of the New York Times. Not that section, the weekend section will actually tell you what's good and what's bad. It will tell you, however, whether you should get a babysitter, will tell you whether you can get a seat in the local Broadway show in the weekends. It will give you, to some extent, information about the jazz joints, which I think is basically useful section, and will, to a large extent, provide a guide for people who are interested in what is new in the cultural life of New York City. Section D, which is the business day, is perhaps for the New York Times and for its readers, the most significant section in the paper, because it's in section D that the New York Times has breathing down its neck, the Wall Street Journal, which has undoubtedly become really the paper of record in terms of what really matters in news for the people of the city of New York, which is the business and all issues related to business. Later I'm going to be talking about the business section of the New York Times, because I believe that the business section of the New York Times is essentially what the New York Times has become as an original contribution to New Yorkers and their desire for news. Let's get back to the news section. To what extent does the New York Times provide news? Well, you might say that the New York Times in section A is basically a newspaper about international and national news. And essentially, as I'll show in the next segment of this show, its news is determined by, with some exceptions, namely the investigative reporters, what it is that the governments of major world powers and the government of the United States chooses to make the news. In structure, then, the New York Times parallels a magazine in the fact that its section C is largely features, and even sections B and A have a considerable feature and a considerable advertising content, and also it parallels television. What's happened to the New York Times is that the 7 o'clock and the 11 o'clock news, which provide about 8 minutes out of 30, or about 18 or 25% of quote hard unquote news, and the rest of the time between 75 and approximately 82% of features, is now mirrored in the New York Times. It doesn't have the graphics, to be sure, but it certainly has the same structure. The assumption about the New York Times readership is that it simply cannot tolerate the density of news that might be provided by an ordinary news medium. The New York Times, therefore, has to parallel TV, it has to parallel the magazines, and its news essentially becomes political handouts from international and national sources. That is not to say that the business section, the cultural section, the science section, and the other sections that are devoted to features do not provide occasionally in-depth coverage. But it is no longer the case that this is a journal which prints all the news that is fit to print. Essentially, news has to fit within a 32-page format. The only reminder we have that the New York Times is an august, conservative, serious newspaper is its old-fashioned non-tabloid format, a format which, to be sure, is as traditional as the history of American journalism. In contrast, the New York Post, the Daily News, the Village Voice are tabloids. But the New York Times looks like it might be a genuine newspaper. What I would like to suggest is that it is no longer really a genuine newspaper. It is a 32-page thin, advertising-ridden, opinion-ridden, national and international news releases from major capitals of the world, a newspaper. As a New York paper, it completely flops. And I'd like to therefore show this in the second section by talking about one specific story, a story of obvious national significance, which does not come out of the press releases of governments, which the New York Times has chosen to ignore.
Thank you.
How many seconds do we have? Let's take a, follow a specific story that is undoubtedly one of the most important stories of the week from September 30th to October the 12th today. On September the 30th, like many other newspapers around the country, the New York Times reported an impending pilots' strike against Continental Airlines, which had demanded of the unions that represented the workers for the airlines a wage cut. The Continental Airlines workers rejected the wage cut and went out on strike. That was on Friday, September the 30th. It was on the front page of the New York Times, and by Saturday, although there was a pilot's story, and you could see there's a pilot's story, you would think it was the same pilots that went on strike against Continental Airlines, by Saturday, October 1st, those pilots disappeared and new pilots appeared, pilots that were asking for the end of the boycott against the Russians for their caper of the Korean Airlines 007. This is the last time that the Continental strike is featured in the New York Times news section, October 1st, 1983. On Saturday, October 8th, we get a news story about the Continental Airlines strike, but it is in the business day of Saturday, October 8th, and it is a kind of a roundup story of how the Continental Airlines strike is doing, a wrenching week at airline. This story has not been preceded by a systematic coverage by the New York Times staff of what has now become one of the major issues, not only in labor relations, but also the major issue for the airlines. Can collective bargaining survive the deregulation of airlines, which means that there will be no regulation of rates and wages have to be negotiated across the table at a condition of recession in the airlines. On Sunday, October the 9th, in the business section again, we get a story about how the corporate assault on wages is going on, and the corporate assault on wages mentions the Continental Airlines strike. In the corporate assault on wages story, there's a quite accurate story by Stephen Greenhouse, a reporter for the New York Times, about how now the New York, the corporations have decided that in the light of deregulation and of recession, the way they're going to deal with their loss of profits and the threats that they have to their industrial position is to make the workers pay. It's a decent story, and so is the one on the 8th, but the story is from the point of view of business. The question for the New York Times is not whether workers' wages and working conditions will be maintained in the light of the corporate assault on wages, but whether corporate profits will be maintained, which I suppose is really an appropriate discussion for a business page of a daily newspaper. The fact of the matter is that in the 10 or 11 days that the New York Times has had the opportunity to cover the Continental Airlines strike, we cannot find in the news section any serious systematic coverage of the strike. Now, this, of course, compares very unfavorably to their meticulous, many-faceted coverage of the Soviet downing of the Korean airline 007 over the Sakhalin Islands several months earlier. The Times was full of front page and middle page coverage of that strike, of that event. But the Continental Airlines strike, which is being covered, by the way, meticulously by the Wall Street Journal as a business story, is only covered by the New York Times as a business story. It is not covered by the Times as a serious national event. This is an indication of the fact that the New York Times, as a magazine, is capable of giving adequate, although superficial, coverage of sports, of the living, of furniture, of science, often of entertainment, but is not really capable any longer of giving systematic coverage of significant news stories unless they are international news stories and unless they are significantly fed to them by government agencies. It is clear that the continental struggle is a very, very controversial struggle, and so controversial that the New York Times can barely, in its main body of news coverage, define it as a serious and a worthy news story. Had I the time, I could show that there are many other news stories. Of course, New York, forget it. New York doesn't count for the New York Times. But even national news stories about real social movements, real struggles of people, real activity. This continental strike is duplicated potentially in many other instances. The New York Times simply doesn't care. What it really does care about is international news on the one hand, White House handouts, the occasional investigative reporting by very good reporters of the New York Times, and a whole significant magazine format which renders the New York Times as a newspaper of record basically defunct. I think the New York Times is essentially entertainment, and I think we ought to be treating the New York Times as nothing more than whiling away our times when we have nothing better to do.
People are queer, they're always crowing, scrambling and rushing about. Why don't they stop someday? Address themselves this way. Why are we here? Where are we going? It's time that we found out. We're not here to stay. We're on a short holiday. Life is just a bowl of cherries. Don't make it serious. Life's too mysterious. You work, you save, you worry so. But you can't take your dough when you go, go, go. So keep repeating it's the berries. The strongest oak must fall. The best things in life to you were just lost. So tell me, how can you ever lose what you never own? Life is just a bowl of cherries, so live and laugh at it all.